Bent Larsen won a lot of tournaments in his career. He was known as the tournament winner. And today we're going to look a little bit at the secret behind all those tournament wins. And well, I can lift some of the suspense here by saying that the one key element is to win a lot of games. And to win a lot of games, you have to have many different weapons in your arsenal, and Larsen did that. He had weird openings, trying to confuse his opponent. He was a very keen tactician, but he also had a lot of positional skills. And one of the things he was most proud of was his endgame technique, which he believed was in world class. And I think he was correct in this. I think nowadays they are just as good technique, but back in the 70s he was maybe one of the best players in that part of the game. When we're going to see a game that the attention to was drawn to me by the loser of the game, who said that this made a big impression on him, that it taught him a lot, because he didn't imagine he could lose this way. So let's plunge into it. We are having Lars Schandorff versus Bent Larsen, and it's the Danish Championship in 1989. So it was long ago. Lars is white, and Larsen plays the Queen's Indian defense. And this is known as the Petrosian variation. And Larsen, as usually, comes with some ideas from himself. Bishop e7, and here I think White might want to go here. Actually, this makes some sense to play d5 and avoid, because after this d5, it's Black is probably okay, and he may benefit from not having put his bishop on b7 after take. He will see takes back with the pawn. And of course, one of the things that was Larsen's main strength, he was not afraid of anyone, and he always played for a win. And you have to get a lot of wins if you want to win tournaments. You cannot make draws, and then win one game. It's just not enough. So you have to take chances. You have to go out there and accept the risk of losing. And this he had no problems with. He always had very good excuses when he lost. But he was not afraid to lose, definitely not. And we start to see the idea. And White is developing quite nicely here. Bishop here, and makes sense. Exchanging the good bishop, Black's good bishop. Notice that this bishop here is supposed to be a little bit better than this bishop here, due to the pawn structure in the center. Because White's pawn is on Black, meaning that the white squared bishop has free range moving, and this bishop is on White, and Black's pawn on the center is on White, so it can only defend, not attack. And this is a very slight thing, and one or two moves away, and nothing will come to that, but sometimes this can be very meaningful as an advantage. Okay, all normal moves, and this also makes sense, exchanging this, and it makes sense because you're trying to keep Black with just having this poor guy here, and if you have a knight versus that bishop, it can be a serious advantage, and we probably will look into this in later videos. It's very instructive. It's very sort of deep chess knowledge, and I think it's very suitable for GM talks, because I kind of like this stuff. But for the moment, we'll go a little bit fast until Black White is playing pretty aggressively here, trying to get some momentum going, and you probably have a slight advantage. But it's if you see, it's not easy to sort of increase the pressure, and that's a problem if your pieces stop sort of could be able to go forward, and now Black, it's Black's turn, and knight is coming in, and the knight is kicked back, and here Black sort of solves his problem. Bishop goes here, And due to the pin here, white is forced to allow black to take the knight. So, but I don't think Schandorff was that sad just yet. His position is solid. He cannot be worse in this position, I think. But not being worse is not the same thing as not being able to lose. And okay, then we can exchange rooks here. And I think just taking and rook c7 is the right way, and this is also what white does. And here I think white should start. I think white thought he had a clear advantage, and he doesn't. And that's a problem when you believe you have an advantage and you believe you're sort of supposed to do something, and nothing is really working because you don't have an advantage. That's often a problem. So white starts to push his pawns, and he should be a little bit careful with that. And in general, you should be very careful to push your pawns. White has this pawn here, making this knight slightly difficult to dislodge from e4 due to the potential weakness of this square, which is not a big thing. But if you play f3, then you also weaken the black squares and the d pawn. So white has to think a little bit about how to put his pieces, and he didn't manage to do that. He started, okay, I will push forward, and it's not a bad idea to gain space on the green side. The problem is, of course, that you might, if you also go here, then black has this maneuver here and putting a sort of a stopping the c5 from being a problem, and maybe the white pawns can become weak. And black does what he always do in this position. He starts to centralize the king, getting the king, and d4. And this is already a little bit suspicious. Because whenever you play g4, you always create a lot of weaknesses. So I'm always very, very careful. I'm sitting like, don't move the d-pawn, even though it looks good. Temporary, in the long run, it always creates a lot of weakness. So unless you get something pretty fast, or you can push black and avoid that he exploits the squares. And what are the problem? One of the problems is this square, and of course this square, and this square, and this square. And we will see all this in the game. So g4 is a very nice instructive mistake. It's not a losing mistake, but it is a sign that white thinks he's supposed to be better, and he's not. And d4 actually doesn't make any sense, because what's the plan behind it? You want to play d5, then you will weaken your pawn structure, and black will not weaken anything. So king e7, continuing the plan, and white should of course do the same. And here white decided, okay, I have the c5, so I'm just gonna go back and say I'm fine. I cannot be worse in any possible way here. And of course it's correct. And black plays rook b7, getting ready for this, and making sure that he will get control over the seventh rank eventually. He's also getting maybe ready for this, and then he frees this rook to go to the e file. So this is also interesting. A nice little move, and sort of hard to understand. Of course, white could always exchange one rook, but it's not really what white wants. But at the same time, if there's nothing to do in the c-file, the rooks are just standing there. So it's not so easy at all. King d2, that's also a move without a purpose, really. Because does the king belong here, or does it belong maybe here? I think it belongs on d3. So I think not moving towards the center is a mistake. Okay, and last, let's continue the journey. There are two open files, and notice that he wants to have the king helping controlling those files. And white should have done the same. White has a plan here. He's getting ready to push this one, put the knight in here, maybe put the knight here, and maybe do something here, and getting maybe this to become a weakness. But it's sort of very optimistic. Black plays knight here, prevents this knight from going. And I think around here, white started to be confused because his plans start to look bad. Do you want to play knight f5 and get a weak pawn on f5? And black might even not take it. He can go knight c4. No, he cannot go. The d pawn is hanging. Anyway, you don't really want that. That was not the idea behind this is the way of playing. And so white plays rook here. It looks like a multi-purpose move. It can swing to the e-file, and black continue his plan of taking over the center, Larsen realized, okay, I don't need him to be able to play b4 anymore, so I will do this. And white sort of accept that he doesn't have anything going on the king side at all, and d4 was probably not good, and he played back. And maybe already here he should have started to think about this square. And at the moment, the knight is as far away as it can be when it's standing close, because it takes a lot. This is noticeable, but it will come there. It will come. Rook c8. Okay, well, one rook with the king on d7. The king can sort of control the open files, so exchanging one rook makes sense. And I think this was the plan the whole time. And here it comes. And black just get ready to put the rook on the e-file. And if white goes in the e-file, black will go in the c-file. And this is white's problem with not having the king on d3 or d2 as black does. So he starts to correct that. And now we see the problem with g4. Here comes a little bit of annoyance. You don't want to take that, because after something like this, these pawns will be weak, and white's pawn structure will be, what you call, compromised or fractured. So you this is not what you want. So you want to keep your pawn structure together. This is a general rule for these kind of endings. But it will come under pressure, and it's not so easy. And the thing is, this position should still be, I think a computer will hold this position without problems. But for a human, it's already kind of difficult. You will have a nasty defensive task ahead of you. And I think Lars probably still believe that this should be easily drawn. I should not lose this. It's a symmetrical pawn structure in the middle. We have knight and rook. I don't have any serious weakness. What's to worry about here? But it gets worse. Knight back, and rook comes in here, ready to take and swing in. And here we see the difference. The knight is now sort of ridiculous here, and white black just secured this square, and this square is nothing. So it's but this square is everything, because from here it's hitting that pawn. Okay, there's also a weakness on the queen side. When you move pawns, you create weaknesses, and this was also the case. White is annoying black. And he has to go in between because he's not interested in a draw, and he doesn't want to go to the B file because then it's too far away from the E file. So something like King ED2 and Rook E3 would be annoying. And this is also another thing. The activity of the pieces is very important. By the way, this constellation is treated in one of Carsten Müller's great DVDs on the endgame. He has a series of 14 DVDs on the ending, and I thought this, I think it's number 9, was one of the best of in the series. And the things that you're supposed to look at is activity of the king, the rook, and the knight, and also zugzwang, and sort of domination. And we will see all these things play out here in this very instructive ending. So here it's white to move. He doesn't really have a nice move. You don't want to move the knight because of a check and rook a3 and white, black become very active and white is not ready for anything. So okay, you move the king and black can play king here where you want to be. And notice that something like this can now be answered by the knight here. And this will actually make the knight very active because it can jump into a lot of squares, making and the corvus jump back. So white doesn't really want the knight there. Rook e3, and here comes probably very surprising move. And this is also shows why Ben Larsen was so dangerous. He said, okay, what's the feature of the position? Is the open h file of any use? Maybe, or maybe not. Okay, and what this move does is making this weakness standing there. And this is, of course, not a weakness if you can't attack it, but it's a weakness if you can attack it. And at the moment, it's clearly attackable with the knight here. So, and this is a bad move, just giving away tempo. White should immediately start the regrouping here with the knight here. Rook f8 and covering this pawn and getting ready to maybe strike in the f file because there's also a pawn here and a knight here. So there's another route, and notice that this counterplay with rook b3 is gone now because of b3. So knight is coming, and it's landing on a nasty square near you very soon. So this, which looks very symmetrical, they have the same pawn structure. Only difference is the activity of the pieces, and this here and here, and this constellation is so much in black's favor that white is close to lost here. It's already really nasty. Knight coming and allowing it here is not nice, so keeping it out. But here comes the f pawn, and of course black foresaw that he would use the f file to attack when he played rook f8, just putting it mysteriously behind a pawn, but it was with aggressive intentions. White defense, and here you don't want to give the f file, but you also don't want to give black a passed pawn. So it's there. The only good move is this, but now white is more active, black is more active than before, and this position is horrible for white. You have weaknesses here, here, and here, and the clumsiness of these three pieces that are kept sort of in a lock and chain is also a big problem. Rook h1 could threaten something, maybe not threaten something. And this is and what Larsen will do in this kind of position is he will maneuver around and waiting for a mistake. He will keep his advantage and wait for a mistake. Okay. So the rook can move here, here, and here. The knight can't move because this pawn is hanging, and maybe the king can move. It's not clear if it wants to move. Played and taking away squares from the king. Oops. From this. And notice that the king cannot move to f2 anymore because the knight takes d4 would come. So it goes here. And avoiding any kind of counterplay against this pawn, which was black's white's hope that he could maybe somehow, if he could somehow get this going, black plays knight d8, coming from a different route. Knight c6, and we see there is a nice outpost here, and already it's a disaster, because something like this is really, really unpleasant. And here it's zugzwang again. So what to do? He played rook e3 and the knight came in, and then here white blundered, but black is winning. He played this, and after this he could resign. And there was no doubt in my mind that even though the computer says something like +3 here, and it is winning for black. White's knight is simply too passive. The rook is too passive, and the weaknesses will, one of them will fall eventually. So Larsen will jump around with the knight and the rook, keeping white locked in, and set a lot of traps, and white will fall for one of them, and like he did here. So this is part of the secret behind Ben Larsen's success as a tournament winner. He was simply very, very good at grinding out these kind of wins from these kind of positions, or any position. You could win from any position, and that's a good skill to have. I hope you enjoyed this video. I know that there are a lot of sort of demand for Bent Larsen videos, and we will have more of those, of course, because he was a great figure in Danish chess, and people are interested in all around the world, not only in Denmark. Thank you for watching. This was GM Talks with Sune Berg Hansen.